Tim Norman pleads not guilty to all charges. On the Case starts right now. Welcome back, everyone. I'm JSO Extra. And if you are new here, go ahead and like this video, subscribe to my channel, and hit that notification bell to get the most recent update on cases. Today's video has a lot of information, so let's get started. I'm going to be giving an overview of Tim Norman's hearing that took place in St. Louis, Missouri on Tuesday, October 13th at 2:30 p.m. The hearing was heard by Judge Nanette Baker in courtroom 13N in the Federal Courthouse of the Eastern District of Missouri. Tim's appearance on Tuesday was for the purposes of an initial appearance hearing within the Eastern District of Missouri, an arraignment hearing, and also a detention hearing. Now, if you can remember from my previous videos, Tim did have an initial appearance hearing in Jackson, Mississippi when he was arrested back in August of this year. But now that he has been transferred from the state of Mississippi to the state of Missouri, he has to again do an initial appearance in the courtroom that falls within the jurisdiction of this case. In regards to the initial appearance hearing, the judge asked Tim Norman to step forward and be sworn in, and she asked him a series of questions such as his age, his date of birth, and if he understands the charges that have been brought against him. And at that point, Tim's initial appearance hearing was concluded. In regards to the arraignment hearing, the prosecution and also the judge had to clarify the timeline in the sequence of events from the moment that Tim was first arrested. On August 11, Tim was charged in a complaint against him regarding conspiracy. On August 18th, Tim was officially indicted for the charges of murder for hire, conspiracy to commit murder for hire resulting in death, and conspiracy to commit mail or wire fraud. Tim's initial appearance was scheduled in Mississippi on August 20th, and on August 24th, Tim waived his right to a detention hearing within the state of Mississippi. So in Mississippi, he had the opportunity to contest detention, but he waived that right and agreed to be detained in Mississippi jails at that time. Tim had a hearing set in St. Louis on September 16th, but that's when he did not give consent to have his likeness shown in video conferencing. A new hearing was scheduled for September 18th, and once again, Tim did not give consent. Before a new hearing could be scheduled, the judge received notice that Tim would not be able to appear in court because of medical issues regarding COVID. It was stated in the hearing that sometime between Tim being arrested in Mississippi and transferred from Mississippi to St. Louis, he either came in contact with someone who had COVID or he contracted COVID himself. So during that time, Tim had to be mandatory quarantined for 14 days, which is why it took so long for Tim to have another hearing scheduled. After he got out of quarantine, he had a hearing scheduled on this past Friday, which was October 9th. As I mentioned in my previous video, Tim obtained new counsel with John Rogers, and John Rogers asked for a continuance so that he can get more familiar with Tim's case. The continuance was granted by Judge Baker, and Tim's hearing was scheduled for Tuesday, October 13th, which Tim did appear at in person. Within the arraignment hearing, the judge asked the defense attorney, John Rogers, what Tim's plea was in these charges, to which John Rogers replied that my client pleads not guilty on all charges. So just to recap, that is murder for hire, conspiracy to commit murder for hire resulting in death, and conspiracy to commit mail or wire fraud. Now that Tim's plea of not guilty has been heard and put into the record, that ended the arraignment hearing. At this point, we move on to the detention hearing, which is where the judge will determine if Tim should remain in detention within the court system in jail, or if he'll be released on bond until the time of his trial. The detention hearing began with the prosecution giving reasons as to why the judge should rule in favor of detention. There are several factors that the prosecutors brought up, including one, that Tim was being charged with crimes that had a penalty of life in prison without the possibility of parole, and also the death penalty. Typically in the state of Missouri, whenever there's a case involving a life sentence or the death penalty, the judge has more commonly ruled in favor of detention. The prosecution also stated that the nature and circumstances of the offense warrants detention. In addition to that, the weight of the evidence against the defendant also warrants detention. And finally, that the testimony of Terica Ellis in her detention hearing was grounds for Tim to be remanded until his trial. After the judge heard what the prosecution had to say, she turned it over to the defense attorney to advocate on Tim's behalf. Tim's attorney, John Rogers, began with contesting some information that was presented in the pretrial hearing. During the pretrial, prosecution presented evidence that showed that Tim was arrested in August of 2018 in Houston for an assault charge, and Tim's attorney wanted to stipulate to the record that that was an alleged assault. And the reason why Tim was even charged for assault was because he was working in the Sweetie Pie's restaurant in Texas. A fight broke out among some of the patrons. Tim intervened to try to break up the fight. And at that point, the police arrived. The people involved in the fight sued Sweetie Pie's. And then a year after the civil suit was filed, Tim was charged with assault. But Tim has not admitted fault in those assault charges. So at this time, they are just allegations. And John Rogers pushed to have that change from the pretrial hearing information. The reason why Tim's attorney brought this up is because he goes on to say that the last time that Tim admitted guilt and was in trouble was when Tim was 17 years old and was arrested for armed robbery. So John Rogers was trying to establish that Tim hadn't been in trouble with the law for the past 34 years. Now, the prosecution did mention that another reason for Tim's detention was that he had a lack of community ties, but John Rogers argued that the lack of family ties was ridiculous. If Tim were to be released, Tim would be living with his mother, Robbie Montgomery, in her home in St. Louis, Missouri. Tim's attorney also went on to say that Tim has a primary residence within the city of St. Louis. Rogers mentioned that if Tim was released with pretrial monitoring and supervision, that he would have a job with the family business in St. Louis, and that he would have the finances to pay for any in-home confinement. In addition to being able to live in St. Louis in the jurisdiction of his case and also be employed in St. Louis, Tim could also be employed in Jackson, Mississippi and have pretrial monitoring and supervision there as well. Rogers went on to mention that Tim has two children, two sons, one by the name of Timmy, the other one by the name of Jace, who would need access to their father. And they would need to have access to him within the city of St. Louis, which were all reasons why Tim should not be considered a risk of flight. After hearing the prosecution and the defense, the judge decided to conclude the detention hearing for today. She wants to take some time to review all of the evidence and make her decision at a later date. So Tim will have another detention hearing in order to hear the judge's decision regarding his detention. During the hearing, some important information was brought up, which I want to discuss now. Now, many of you have asked if Ms. Robbie was paying for Tim's new attorney. During the hearing on Tuesday, John Rogers made a statement that Tim is requesting additional counsel in this case. When someone faces the death penalty, that additional counsel is requested, but the request has to come directly from the defendant, which is what happened during Tim's hearing. They made it on the record that Tim was requesting additional counsel. Tim was being represented by a public defender, but that public defender withdrew from the case. And then that's when John Rogers joined Tim's legal team. John Rogers had previously been a CJA, which is a criminal justice attorney I mentioned before, but he was working as private counsel in regards to Tim. However, John Rogers is requesting to be identified as learned counsel. So what that means is the Federal Public Defender Organization has the right or is able to identify an attorney as someone who is capable of representing a defendant in a case involving the death penalty or a life sentence without the possibility of parole. If the Federal Public Defender Organization deems John Rogers as learned counsel, then the public defender's office will pay for John Rogers' attorney fees. He even stated in the hearing that he would not be able to start mediation on Tim's behalf until he was designated as learned counsel. That way he could apply for compensation. He also stated that if the public defenders wanted to appoint a CJA, that would be secondary counsel, and then John Rogers would be lead counsel, he would be okay with that. But the main issue is that John Rogers wants to get this designation or determination from the Federal Public Defender Organization so that he can get paid. Now, that doesn't mean that John Rogers isn't currently being paid by someone. It just means that if he does get this designation, he would be paid as if he were a public defender. Just as they did during Terica's hearing and during YL's hearing, the prosecution made a motion for a complex case finding. The reason being is because the prosecution has a voluminous amount of evidence that they need to get, not only gather, but organize before they can send it over to Tim's defense attorney. And that's going to take time in order to do that. And also the nature of the crime is why they're asking for a complex case finding. Tim's lawyer said that he didn't have an opinion either way, but the judge did rule, grant the motion for a complex case finding because she granted the same motion in Terica's hearing and the same motion in YL's hearing. So now all three defendants in this case have been granted a motion for a complex case finding, which means it's going to take a little bit more time in order for them to gather evidence, but it won't count against them against the Speedy Trial Act. So no one will be in violation of trying to delay this trial on purpose. Moving forward, here are the next steps regarding the case. We still have to have a secondary detention hearing for Tim, where we will hear the judge's decision on whether or not he should be detained. And then also on December 2nd, there's going to be an attorney-only conference where they're going to do a status hearing to see if all of the attorneys involved in this case have had an opportunity to read over all of the evidence and discovery and if they feel comfortable with moving forward. And after that, we'll see if there is going to be a trial date set, if there is going to be a jury survey or jury selection, but I will keep you guys updated as this case progresses. That's all I have for today. And if you haven't done so yet, go ahead and like this video, subscribe to my channel, and hit that notification bell to get more updates on cases. Follow me everywhere at JSO Extra. And if you want me to look in on a case specifically, then send me a tweet. Use the hashtag J on the case so that I can easily find your tweet. I've gotten 2 tweets thus far, and I am doing research on those cases. So thank you so much for your submissions. Thank you all for listening. Thank you for watching. And until next time, stay safe.